Ara, that was a fantastic lecture. It was really so rich, and I won't be able to do justice to it in any kind of comment that I would make right now. I'm just reacting immediately to the film. And if you allow me just to react for a second to the last reel, I'd just love to start with that, just in terms of discussing, because I just watching that last reel where we get these two planes of action with the woman sitting in front, the sex happening back, but the woman positioned very clearly in such a way so as to allow us to see the sexual act. I had to think of just what a radical difference that makes to blowjob, where it's specifically framed so that we don't see a sexual act. And so it seems clear that Warhol was interested in using cinema to explore many different ways of depicting sex, suggesting sex. I don't know if that is of any interest to you.
What if I said no?
Then I would have something else to say.
I'm teasing. Well, in art history, we talk about the relationship between the figure and the ground. And in couch, which, unlike blowjob, unlike the many frontally staged films that Warhol makes during that period, the relationship between the figure and ground is, that's the whole film. That's absolutely crucial. And the antics, the performers in the foreground, whether they be like Ivy Nicholson here, like very calm, or if they're really misbehaving, like we see so many times over and over again, is what constitutes the relation, the meaning of the background sex. And so I think for Warhol, sex is all of those things in the foreground and the background, right? Mm-hmm. That it would be a very superficial distinction to mm-hmm. think that mm-hmm. the penetration that's happening on the couch is the sex, but mm-hmm. the person sitting in front is not the sex. That's not, I don't think, the way he thinks about it, that the entire mise-en-scene of the performers constitutes what sexuality is. And I wonder sometimes if, you know, mise-en-scene is even the right term, you know, that maybe mm-hmm. mise-en-abîme, that this is an abyss of sexuality. Mm-hmm. And he places these performers in abyss mm-hmm. in the field. You know, mm-hmm, that he's actually, mm-hmm. he's a filmmaker who's known for a very flat, frontal, stationary camera, not moving. I mean, that's not always the case, but that's kind of classic Warhol in this period. And this is one of the rare examples where he's really staging the relationship between different planes of action.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay, I just have two quick little other comments, and I'd love to open it up for comments and questions from all of you, because we then move to the second part of the evening. I mean, there are different planes of action, of course, in a film like Harlot, although it all takes place on the couch. Mm-hmm. It's a different couch. Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. not this couch. And it, I was interested in just the, you talked about the couch as showroom. Mm-hmm. And I'd love to hear more about that, because the couch, watching this after this whole series where we saw Henry Geltzahler sitting on this couch, and I think that was shot in August, so right in the midst right of this. So I couldn't help but thinking of Henry Geltzahler sitting in this, like, sexualized couch now, this in a film like Synths, which we haven't seen here, a film fragment where the Warhol factory replays the John F. Kennedy assassination.
Although you'd never know it if you didn't read the description, because it's just mayhem on the screen.
Although they do say, you know, Hondin says, you know, I'm the president here, and, you know, there's the LBJ thing. There are the moments that suggest it, but the couch is the limousine. And so I'm just thinking of the different functions of the couch. Mm-hmm. So I thought the couch as showroom that you offered us seems very central to your argument about sex and capitalism and the project and the objects being on display being for sale. I just wonder if you have some more, if you can explain a little bit more about that.
One of the things that I was talking to Henning about before the screening is that just how kind of precious and ephemeral the knowledge about, you know, experimental film is. Mm. This is depressing, but that's where I like to go. But between beginning my book and finishing my book, which, you know, took too long, but a lot of the people that I had spoken to about the films and gathered information from had died, and, you know, some quite suddenly. And so the gossip that you hear about the films, it's very fragmentary, and you never, it's not entirely reliable, but it's sort of what you get. It's sort of what you base, you know, your knowledge about the production on. And I talked to Billy Name, who's very helpful to a lot of people. He was the photographer at the factory. And some of his memories of being there were what I based my research on in Couch, not exclusively. But the way he described the filmmaking was, you know, I mentioned in my talk that there are 37 reels that were collected. But this number might be greater. It's sort of unclear what was part of Couch, what wasn't part of Couch, how many reels were shot. And so when I asked him, for instance, about the significance about the interracial ménage à trois that I talk about so much in my talk, he said, oh, that was nothing, you know. We didn't make a big deal out of that. That was just what they decided to do. You know, nobody cared. And then I tried to contact... Well, I did contact Gerard Malanga, and he wouldn't speak about it. He doesn't speak about scenes where he's sort of bisexual. Mm-hmm. And then I contacted Kate Helitzer, the woman, and she had helped me on other projects, but she didn't want to talk about this one. And Rufus Collins is dead. And so I thought, you know, is that true that they didn't think it was a big deal or that they weren't doing it for effect? And I thought, you know, quite possibly it is true, but I guess my larger point about the role of the couch is that the very slipperiness of what was and wasn't part of the film, of the deliberateness of the performance or the non-deliberateness, it was just what people were doing while a camera was rolling, you know, the 13 that are selected out of the 37 that we know of, out of the possible 100 that we don't know of, it suggests, just that kind of slipperiness suggests that the couch was this performative site, that precisely because you didn't know when you were working, mm-hmm. as opposed to when you were not working, that any of this was film worthy, I think transforms everything into potential labor. That mm-hmm. the kind of visibility of the couch and the possibility that what you just might do on it one afternoon while you're hanging out with your friends might end up as one of the, you know, deliberate segments of a film sort of constitutes everything as work. And that's what became really interesting to me. And I think that's the world we live in. I was very moved recently by Jonathan Crary's latest book, 24/7, where he talks about the machine of capitalism just going on all the time. And there's never any sleep, that sleep is our last defense against capitalism because it's the time the body cannot function and cannot work. And there are all these scientific and economic ways that people, corporations are trying to overcome our basic need for sleep. But when I read that book, it really resonated and really kind of terrified me that we are on this 24/7 cycle. And then I think I see the progenitor of that in a film like Couch. That, like, to be on the couch was to be working, because it was always possible that that would be constituted as spectacle. And I found that very troubling, and I tried to think about, is that it? Is that what Warhol's saying? Like, is Warhol part of the problem, like I ask in my talk? Does he contribute to this around-the-clock cycle of performativity and labor that we are also exploited by? And I tried to think through that and find, I don't know why I was so determined to find a redeeming potential, but I was, and I feel like for myself, I found it.
Yeah, just, there was a comment already. Okay. Yes.
I want to speak about two things, and this is the importance of no sound in his films, and the importance of drugs in the factory, and maybe also in the capitalism thing, what they need, what they take, maybe, don't know, speed, cocaine or something like that. But for me, most important is this no sound thing, which I think is very important for these kind of films, where you only have the picture and you look around and you don't be disturbed by the sound. On the other hand, I also like his film with this direct sound, but I think he's very important with this no sound. And there's, on my mind, no other filmmaker, only Stan Brakhage, which is working with only this picture, with this possibilities that the film brings in with no sound.
Okay, so Brakhage is a really good comparison, and World, you know, of course, does make sound films, but most of the early work is silent. Hundreds of films he makes are silent. I mean, one of, there's several ways that he alienates regular life, right? So I called my talk porn, you know, I think of him as like porn realism, but there are several really important ways that it's not realistic at all. The absence of sound being one of them, the fact that it's black and white, and also the fact that it's slowed down, right? So that even though each reel in the can is 3 minutes, he shoots it at silent speed, and then it's almost 4 minutes. And so you think about the discipline of them eating a banana, like taking 3 minutes to eat a banana, and then it's, they're already moving slow, and then it's slowed down a little bit. So I would just, you know, answer that it's one of the kind of defamiliarizing techniques, and I have my own thoughts about his use of silence, but I would be more, since I've lived with my thoughts for a long time, I would be more curious to hear what you think about the effect of silence in the film.
For me, this is very important because you are focused on the picture only, on the things which are happening, and you are not disturbed by comments or some noises or so, and you have a totally different perception of what is happening there, yeah? And I think, Brakhage is one example of filmmaker which is working only with this, with no sound, because he understood there is something totally different to express. And a lot of, I think, in many experimental films nowadays, the people are afraid of not using sound, because, and then if you look at these films and you imagine there would be some kind of music or thing, it would be totally smashed.
Yeah, I mean.
So for me, it's a very important thing. I'm also filmmaking, and my earlier work is also working with no sound and with only the image.
I mean, you're talking about sound, I think, because that's part of the cinematic sensory regime, right? That we have the visual and then we have the audible. But if you think about sexuality, we have tactility and we have the sense of smell and the sort of spatial. All of these other things are excluded and we don't even remark about it. And so when I was thinking about Warhol's perversion, his perversion of sexuality, that part of the perversion of pornography, I'm using that term carefully, is that it focuses only on the visual and usually audible regime of sexuality, which is entirely different than how many of us experience sexuality. And so I feel like the absence of sound is really sort of focused on this visual perversion of what sexuality is, that it's something to be seen rather than something to be felt. And all of the performers are performing for the camera, rather than performing for like mutual sensory, you know, experience of each other. And when that breaks, as I think it does in the interracial scene, although my cues are only visual, it's very profound. But what do you think?
No, I think you explained that nicely. There's some other questions.
Yes, I got a mic. Also a comment about the sound, the absence of sound, and for me, it was actually disturbing, but in a nice way, the fact that there was no sound, because you see them talk and you see them laugh and you want to know what they're actually saying. And I think that might help also to understand if this is really labor for them or really sex, or maybe it's just fun, because there is a lot of complicity among the performers. They know what they're doing. Also at the end, the woman, she's very disciplined, but there is a moment she's laughing and she's very aware of her position, of the way she's framing the scene. And that's why she becomes part of the sexual scene. I think you put that very nicely. But I think if there would be sound, it would become a totally different experience for the spectator. But I actually had a question about your definition or your distinction between, on the one hand, easy sex, or the sex where we don't think about it, and then the more reflexive sex, the difficult sex, maybe. And I wonder how that relates also to the experience of this film spectator in this particular film, because you start off in a kind of difficult, it's a difficult situation, the first reel. So it's a decision also of the montage, why this first scene where nothing is happening, it's kind of a difficult, and you get through the film and it works towards a kind of orgastic moment. So it gets easier, I think, for the spectator. So, but I don't know how that relates to the distinction between this, I don't know how you call it, the sex.
That you don't think about
it. You don't think about it, and then the one where you think about it, and how that is kind of reflected also in the position of the film spectator who thinks about it and then maybe forgets about the fact that he's watching this, and it becomes easier to watch because he's distracted or he gets used to it or whatever.
Right. I really appreciate that question, Wanda, because it goes straight to the heart of what my book is about, in the sense that as a young experimental film scholar, I would watch avant-garde films and I'd constantly be astonished by the dirty parts, and I'd wonder, why isn't anyone writing about this? You know, why have I read so many descriptions of these films and they never once mention that this is happening? And obviously that's not true anymore, but I sort of had this impression that thinking about sexuality in avant-garde film from the 60s was going to be all these orgasmic moments. You know, like it was going to be the celebration of sex. And instead, I found exactly what you're talking about, that it was about the difficulty of sex as sex, but also the difficulty of spectatorship and of watching. And that the one thing that all the films have in common in my book is that it's very hard to watch them. And it's very hard even to see the sex. And different filmmakers have different strategies for rendering that difficulty. So Warhol stages all of these things happening in the foreground. Barbara Rubin uses superimposition of two reels. Carolee Schneemann collages the film so densely that it's hard sometimes to see the bodies. Paul Sheritz subjects you to an incessant color flicker, which is painful neurologically to watch. And every one of these filmmakers is trying to undermine our ability to see sex. And I think they're thinking about that equation of visuality and sexuality, that to render sex as a visual object of study or a purely visual spectacle is to so alienate sexuality from our experience of it that they compensate. I think the filmmakers try to address that difficulty by making it so hard to see. And so we're having this very self-reflexive experience while we're watching that it's hard to watch, and that's precisely the point, that sexuality, not only is sexuality difficult because of all of these things like inequalities of gender and race and class and all of these things that are being brought up all the time, but sexuality is in so many ways antithetical to cinema, which is about this regime of the visual, and sexuality is about tactility in so many ways. So I think they're trying to thematize that.
Yes, in the back.
I think it's quite funny that he uses a couch as an object where the sexual act is happening and not a bed or a chair.
Yeah.
And I think when he would change the object, the whole meaning of the film would blow away. Like in a bed, it's more, in a marriage, or it's stereotyped. So what's your opinion about that?
That's a great question. I don't know if are you a film student?
Art history.
You should write an essay about furniture in Warhol. I'm not kidding, because you're absolutely right. And so in my chapter on Warhol, the other film that I talk about is Blue Movie. It's a beautiful film. I always try to show it. They never let me show it. They never let anyone show it. It's not personal to me.
We tried to get it shown here for you, but it was a German version. But it showed immediately on German TV, dubbed.
Right. So that's part of the ritual. It's like you try to get Blue Movie, you don't get Blue Movie, and then you show something else. But Blue Movie is on a bed, and it's a couple, and it's almost 2 hours long, and it's just on a bed in this apartment. And you are right that it is entirely different. And it's this architecture of intimacy where the couch is immediately this public form of architecture. I had the privilege and pleasure of seeing a film called Three. The Warhol Estate's very difficult, right? Because they don't let all the films out in one day. Like when you're old, you'll have seen many more films than I'll have seen, right, in my lifetime. But they sort of like bleed it out, and they keep certain ones in the vault. And so they took this film Three out. It's from 1964 also. It's 9 minutes. It's three reels. And it's one of the other early pornographic films. And three reels, I won't tell you too much because you'll be so disappointed you can't see it, but it's all in a bathroom. It's all sex in a bathroom. And so you could just do like toilet, couch, bed. It's like the significance of that architectural surround is totally profound, because the bathroom's so different from a couch, because it's this private corner of a public space. It's the bathroom of the factory versus the couch, which is the showroom. I mean, the bathroom was a different kind of showroom. I like your laugh, Vincent. It was appropriate if you had seen the film. Yeah.
There's also different, I mean, if you're going on with the furniture and the bed, you know, there's the scene in the bed sequence of Chelsea Girls. There's a film Warhol made called The Bed, based on the play by Robert Hyde. And also there's like in this, I think, later 60s, a film by James Broughton, the American avant-garde filmmaker, out gay man who made a film called The Bed, where you see that's incredibly, for me, less sexy than this, because I would still maintain that for me. I actually don't find it a difficult film to watch. I don't want to intervene too much right now, but I'd love to talk more about that, about what is indeed so difficult to watch there. But James Broughton's film, The Bed, is really, I think, completely unsexy about people, all different kinds of configurations, men, women, together, not together. I don't think they have explicit sex, but they're on the bed. It seems to completely de-eroticize a bed, whereas this, to me, seems to activate a kind of erotic potential in a couch. But I think the furniture, I mean, there's your nice Doktorarbeit Thema.
That film, The Bed, that was, my book comes from my dissertation, because I have so few ideas. And I write about the bed in the dissertation. It didn't make it in precisely because it's not about
Warhol or Broughton's The Bed?
Broughton's The Bed, so, and it's like a bed. It's kind of like what I thought avant-garde sex films were going to be like, this like amazing overthrowing of erotic repression. It's like that's the film, and the bed's out in nature, and all these, you know, beautiful hippies are having sex on it, and you could just snore right through it. You know, like there's no tension, there's no frame. And so couch, it's like the 3 minutes of the reel, the furniture of the couch, the distractions in the foreground. These are the elements of the frame against which sexuality is constantly pushing, and it creates the tension that makes it interesting. That's like sex is that tension, right? And the bed doesn't have it. It's just like hippie free-for-all out in the woods. It's my worst nightmare.
Okay, Vincent has a comment.
I would say that the bed is for me some kind of the humor of Broughton. It's kind of humoristic film for me. It's
more this kind of
it's
humor.
It's a lovely film. It's like it's it kind of it really gets to his generosity in a way, you know? I'm just making fun of it because I had a chance to, but it's a beautiful, generous film, but it's so different, right, than Blue Movie, which is all about the impossibility of two people when they find themselves, you know, together on a bed and what they have to do. It's the opposite of it.
But Broughton is also some kind of ironic thing in with this bed thing. And I think on his other films, he's always some kind of special humor he tries to express. So for me, it's not so easy to...
I'm glad you're calling me out for that because you're right about that. Yeah.
Okay. Only want to say this.
Maybe I led us astray by bringing that up.
Oh.
Vincent's.
Oh, just two quick remarks. Another one regarding the sound, the other one regarding the sense of smell. We were discussing when we watched Harlot and listened to Mark's talk, the fact that the sound in Harlot is sort of a comment to the image, and that the image is in a way... It's still a silent film, but it's spoken over. And in My Hustler, when the camera turns, a similar thing happens. The comment of the two people sitting in the beach house over the image are sort of like a comment spoken over a silent image. So in a way, there's always this space for comment in Warhol that I think, you know, watching this film, you automatically... You're challenged to comment what you're seeing and try to fill in the empty slots. And about the question of smell, there's one moment in the film that had a strong impact on me, where Gerald Malanga, it's actually Ondine sitting on the sofa, and it's the other guy's getting undressed, and then he's holding his nose, and instantly, you know, the whole question of smell enters the frame, and you start thinking about, you know, okay, he should have washed, or that brings that makes the whole question of smell and of the body and of smell as a part of sexuality into the frame. With the effect, this is basically just to underscore your point. It's another way of making it hard to watch. But I would say that the film very much plays with the sense, or that particular scene very much plays with the sense of smell and brings that particular form of corporeality to our attention as viewers.
That's such a good observation. I mean, obviously the film conjures the other senses, right? But you've noticed a rare moment when it's conjuring smell. It obviously is conjuring sound. Like a lot with the vacuum, you know, like you're hearing that vacuum and people are sort of mouthing words to the camera. You're trying to hear what they're saying. So, I mean, I just really appreciate that observation. I don't have more to add to it, but thank you.
Regina.
Yes, I would like to come back to the couch. I think the couch is, we had this discussion with the Geldzahler movie, that this couch is in the style of Art Deco, and this is a very it's a very artistic object, and so this could relate to your talk about Gesamtkunstwerk, because I think in two or three of these reels we have a chair too, which is also the same style, very nice line. And so I think there's also a relationship to your term of distraction. I think this comes from Krakauer. He talks about industry of distraction. And so I was very fascinated by this picture of the Tiller girls. And I would like to ask you if this could be the Krakauer thought, could be your idea of redemption, of redeeming quality of this film, because Krakauer says in his essay on the ornament der Masse, mass ornament of the mass, I don't know in English.
Mass ornament in English, yeah.
Yes, he tells that art has to refer to this culture industry and to be art. And so this film, with this kind of sexuality everywhere, in the background, in the foreground, as industry of destruction, because I think these people, the woman in the last reel, she's listening to music, and many persons appearing in the foreground, they are listening to music or dancing. So I think this quote, this is a citation of culture industry also. And is it what you mean? I'm not sure if I understand your
yes, that's point. What I mean.
Right, way. The second that relates to the Krakauer argument, you made a distinction between Krakauer and Marcuse's one-dimensional man. And I don't understand really, because I think that's nearly the same idea, to say that one-dimensional man is just operationalizing sexuality, for example. So it's all, there's no transcendentality, there's no transcendence anymore. That's his concept. So it is very close to Krakow or to your utopian idea, bound to exposing alienation, or the affirmation of alienation instead of idealism, and so on. So I don't see the distinction so much.
I really am interested in your comment about the ornamentality of the furniture, which is not something that I've thought about, and you definitely have a good eye for that. And I mean, that's one of the great things about seeing these films that I've seen so many times in a new audience, is that I think I only talk about four of the reels in the film, and then every time I watch it, I think, wow, my talk could be, you know, it could be 1,000 pages, you know, it was already so long, terribly long, and I only talked about a little bit, and there's so much detail that's readable, and so I think, like, why is he quoting this sort of obsolete ornamentality of a different generation? And I always think Warhol's films are about obsolescence, but I never can tell if that's just my own contemporary point of view, but sort of staging the sort of not antiquated, but, you know, furniture of another generation as part of this sort of cultural surround or cultural distraction. I think that's very interesting. I want to think about that more. I am not so foolish to argue the nuances of the Frankfurt School while in Frankfurt. So I will decline from that, distinguishing between Marcuse and Krakauer. I'm afraid to go there. But one thing that I really love about the essay you cited from Krakauer, The Mass Ornament, is that, you know, he's critiquing popular culture for sort of extending the conditions of capitalist production, you know, and it's not, at the beginning of the essay, he's sort of claiming that it's not a relief, it's not a respite, it's just reproducing these conditions. And yet one thing I find so amazing and useful about Krakauer is that he doesn't stop there, that he actually, in the end, thinks it's actually useful, that the very fact that the entertainments and popular distractions are modeled on the capitalist production is what, this is how I read the essay, is what makes them speak, that to the audience that they're speaking to, that were they in another language, they wouldn't be useful at all. And so it's the fact of the kind of iconic similarity between the Tiller Girls and the factory production that makes the Tiller Girls a legitimate expression of that culture, even though he's critical of it. And so I don't think I'm claiming that Marcuse is saying something different than Krakauer there, but Krakauer is talking about the usefulness of that resemblance in a way that helped me think through Couch. But I won't take your dare not in Frankfurt. Yeah.
Winfried Günther.
Even after this discussion, I don't think that I quite grasped one of your main points. So I'm asking again. You argued in your lecture that sexuality for Warhol is not a means of liberation in the sense of Marcuse, and the sexual revolution of the 60s, but on the contrary, kind of a work. And you expressively combined this work with succumbing to the logic of capitalist production. While in the end of your lecture, when you analyzed the film proper, you quite successively named a number of points that contradict this argument, but showed that the film indeed has a lot to offer in terms of the sexual liberation. So to me, it seems I don't bring these two points together. To me, even if it were work, what the people are doing in front of the camera, in the sense of the Warhol quotation you gave, it would not be work in the sense of the logic of capitalist production.
I feel like you did understand the argument of my talk, because I'm interested in that contradiction and how it pivots. So my argument, in a nutshell, is basically that how could this film be liberating? How is Warhol's approach to sexuality liberating when it so precisely mirrors the ethos of capitalism, right? And sort of sex is work, work is sex, it looks identical. How can that possibly be liberating? And then it pivots because it resembles production, capitalist production, and the kinds of alienated relations that are sustained through that. And yet it doesn't produce anything that's useful. And so all of the audience in the 60s who heard, you know, that Warhol's making pornographic films, and they'd go to see the films, and they're like, where's the sex? For all the reasons we talked about, it's so difficult to watch, that they're not making a useful product, that they're actually sort of defying the commoditization of sexuality that they seem to be participating in. And so all of these scenes of queer sex where people are trying to have sex, but it's not working, or just as it's getting good, the real ends are all, these are all instances of non-productivity. So I guess my example is that couch resembles work because everybody's doing their stuff on the factory, but it's like that classic, you know, it's like how we all work. You know, you're sitting at your desk, but you're just checking Facebook. It's like you look useful and you're not, and that's your way of defying it. And in the meantime, you're having fun by kind of perverting the use value of these things that you really look like you're mimicking and you're doing exactly. So there may be like an absence in the argument that is my fault, but I do think you understand. And I think that that contradiction, maybe you're not seeing how I'm getting there because I chop so much out of the talk, but when you described my argument back to me, I thought, yes, that's it. And then you said, and I don't understand. I thought, oh, God. Well, it made sense to me when you said it, so.
And, I mean, they, oh, there's a question.
Yeah, there will be a follow-up on this question.
Sorry, yeah.
You hardly use the word acting, or you hardly were talking about actors there, we see. And I wonder if that would be helpful to do. You were mentioning in your first response that the film is also about foreground and background. So the whole setting for me is very theatrical. Yeah. And if you say that, you can say you were talking in the biker scene about the fact the guy doesn't pay attention to the woman. Now the positions and the postures of the woman are like Playboy choreography, mm-hmm. yeah. And clearly this is a commodified object. Mm-hmm. So why care about it? Why not work on the bike? More interesting. In the second bike scene, there's also getting your hands dirty, lubrication, all this kind of stuff. This is real working on art. So
try
that. I don't know. Do you want to get into that direction or not?
So explain to me how acting helps.
Well, the acting means the acting means that you have to get rid of the work sex opposition. It may not be so helpful, and it's far too direct,
Because you always have an intermediate stage, right? You have the actors in front of the camera, even if they improvise.
And that's obvious for anybody who's watching. Also work and sex simultaneously. Isn't acting, I mean, I use the term performance in the essay, right? Which I'm totally not going to hash out what I think the difference between acting and performance is right now. But I'm not following how acting undermines the work-sex opposition, because like couch acting seems to be both work and sex. But later. Later I'll avoid you like the plague. So we don't have to have that conversation, but thank you.
We should probably close, but if I can just, or maybe Urs has a question, I'll just ask one quick question.
And then I want to give a 1 minute intro to the screen test.
Yeah, perfect. Okay. I have two questions. I'm not sure, somehow the discussion took a track where we somehow have all, or seem to have implicitly agreed it's difficult to watch the film, or is it difficult to watch sex, or is it... I found it an incredible pleasure to watch the film, and I'm sort of unclear about that, about what it is that we're sort of emphasizing difficulty here, and I'm not quite clear on what's so difficult. But the second thing was a bigger thing, the Gesamtkunstwerk. If I understood, you brought it up in relation to Annette Michelson talking about the factory mm-hmm. as a Gesamtkunstwerk, mm-hmm. and in that sense, I found that very interesting, because then that's situating the work, pleasure, acting performance on the couch, whether or not a camera's there, as art. And that then when mm-hmm. the camera is there, mm-hmm. it's then filming it. And then that's changing our whole understanding of these films, that they are part of something else, that the medium may be posing on a couch when there's no camera there. Right. The medium, the sociality in the factory is indeed a medium, has its own medium specificity that has to be put in relationship to these films. Are these films traces of something that has happen? The films have double existences, in a sense, as objects, but also as one way of capturing one view onto the Gesamtkunstwerk that was taking place there. So it's kind of sort of what I got out of you, is almost challenging the medium specificity of these films as films in a very productive way.
Okay, I love the second part of your comment.
But you hate the first part?
No, I just have a very simple answer to that. I think the first part's more simple. So I'll address the first part first. I don't think that difficulty and pleasure are exclusive. I think the pleasure comes through the difficulty, right? And that's why Warhol, notorious, but like many artists, is not to be believed, right? When he's speaking or writing, mm-hmm, in the sense mm-hmm, when he's saying, mm-hmm. Oh, the best kind of sex is not thinking about it. Sex says who? You know, the best kind of sex is the difficult kind of sex that is either punctuated by distraction or triangulated by desire or rendered oblique in a million ways or complicated, right? Like, that's the kind of desire we all fall for. We don't fall for the easy kind. So that is just a front, I think, when he's saying that. That's why in the end I come back to it. Who's to say that the, you know, the sex you don't think about is the good kind, and the menage a trois, because no one's dancing in front of it, is the most intimate reel? What if all the other reels that are possibly convoluted are the more pleasurable ones, right? Mm-hmm. And so I'm problematizing that opposition between difficulty and pleasure. Second part of your comment, you said so beautifully that I couldn't say it better, but it's mm-hmm. this is why I don't want to like follow this too carefully, because it'll just railroad us, but that's why I compared it to the Panopticon of Foucault. It's not an exact metaphor, so I don't want to like debate whether it is or isn't, because that's just pointless. But it's the imagination of the camera, the imagination of the act of recording, that transforms the factory into the Gesamtkunstwerk. That's, I think, your point, whether or not the camera is actually recording. And so the camera is an instrument in that larger, more meaningful medium of sociality. And that's so beautiful how you said it.
Mm. No, I like how you said it.
I just wanted to add one point that was missing for me in our discussion a little bit, because your lecture is called Porn Realist. And when I saw the first scene, it was like the perfect image of a dream, because he's lying there like an angel and looking at him on the couch.
With flowers.
And, yeah, and it's really like heaven. And I just asked me, because you said so many things that were political of this film and very how he wanted to change reality in a way, perhaps, or not, the reality changed after seeing that movie. But how would you see the conflict between dream and reality? Because he explicitly chooses this one for the first part of the movie.
Okay. You set me up perfectly, thank you. So one of the things that I'm arguing is that these oppositions that we think structure everyday life, you know, I said like work and leisure, black and white, public, private, that these oppositions are not in fact constitutive of what we think of reality. That reality embraces the contradiction of them both, right? And so reality includes performance. Right, like one of the things that pornography, mainstream pornography, always claims, which is so unbelievable to all of us, is this rhetoric of authenticity. And Warhol rejects that, and I think that Warhol's films are the more realist because of it, because they don't make these claims to authenticity, and they foreground performance. And so that first scene is a great example of foregrounding performance, right? That this is the kind of performance that's captured at the factory. Nobody's acting like themselves because of that possibility that the camera is always going to intervene. And so that staginess is precisely what constitutes the realism of the film, but also the realism of sexuality that we are always performing. And then there's this wonderful moment, right? I say, I'm such a liar, but I say in my talk, you know, when Piero Hellitzer lies asleep or dead, this is when you know you've like spent too much time writing a book when you can quote every line. Like, I didn't need those papers. I could just give you the talk. That's horrible. It's not true, because then you see him chewing gum. And it just breaks the illusion. And all of these little moments where the performance is ruptured are very deliberate, right? And so it's not a dream, because in the dream he doesn't start chewing gum and sort of, you know, destroy the illusion that he might be asleep or dead, right? And so it's that simultaneity of the performativity, the illusion, and its rupturing that constitutes what I'm calling the realism of Warhol's pornography. Can I give my 1 minute about screen test?
Do it, yes, do it.
Okay, so one of the claims that I make in the, you know, whatever, you heard it, is that Warhol, we really need to think about the kinds of, what Warhol's contributing to pornography. And I try and think that out by looking at Couch and also Blue Movie primarily, although I've thought about, you know, dozens of other films in that regard. A less provocative claim is that Warhol is one of the most prolific portrait makers of the 20th century. And I would say, you know, if Picasso is the most important portraitist of the first half of the 20th century, art historians will beat me later, then Warhol is the most important portrait maker of the second half. And like many of you, I am more intrigued in a way by Warhol's films than his paintings, although as a painter I'm intrigued by them. But I think Warhol's contribution to portraiture, his most important contribution to portraiture, comes not through the screen test, or maybe we're just so used to that I don't want to sing their praises, but through his screen tests. And he makes about 500 of them between 1963 and 1965. They're each, they're 3-minute reels that then will, in projection, will be closer to 4 minutes, and people, different people, you know, luminaries of the art and literary and music and theater world sort of come into the factory, and he takes their portrait in the form of a screen test. And for most of them, the camera is still, and they're black and white, and they're without sound, and this is the standard format. And Warhol instructs people, supposedly gossip has it, not to move. That's the only instruction, don't move. And different people, different sitters interpret this very differently. But one of the things I think is so interesting about this screen test is that they are you know, Warhol called his films stillies instead of movies. And so the portraits, the screen tests are these fascinating portraits where he's interested in what happens to someone sitting still over time. And again, like the gum chewing, like how they break that stillness, because he's working in a medium that's all about movement and time. And so different people responded in different ways. We're going to be watching 10 of them. They're each like between 3 and 4 minutes long. I really encourage you to stay. I have like a little carrot at the end of the stick, which is that the my absolute favorite screen test is the last one we're going to watch. I didn't do it to torture you, although I'd be well, you know, in good company here if I was a torturer. But it's of Anne Buchanan. And meaning Warhol, not you. Yeah, and making you wait for it, you know. Anne Buchanan was a poet. She's the last one. So if you can count to 10, which many of us cannot, you'll know which one when it starts. But she really takes this dictum quite seriously and decides not to move at all. And that for her includes not blinking. And I would argue that this claim about what Warhol's doing to portraiture and what Warhol's doing to pornography come together in this last screen test. That this, in spite of the fact that it doesn't ever show the genitals and it's just this face of this woman who's not blinking, is a thoroughly pornographic film. And if you want to know why, you better sit through all of them. We can talk about it later. Okay.
Thank you, Ara, and everyone, for your discussion.
We will start the movie.
I don't know. Can I just say before, you know, that you guys are the best audience that I've ever, honestly, the best, most thoughtful audience I've ever had the pleasure of talking from this book about. And I don't know where you all came from, but wow, it's been such a great evening. And, you know, you survived most of it, so. Do you want me to tell you why I think the last one's pornographic and then I'm going to run out? No, kidding. I'll entertain a few questions, but we're all tired. I think the last one of Anne Buchanan is pornographic because, remember before we watched the screen test, I was talking about how pornography makes these claims about authenticity, right? And part of the claim that pornography makes about authenticity pivots around involuntary gesture. And in Bela Balázs's really famous, you know, book Film Theory, where he's talking about the close-up, he's a Hungarian film theorist, most famous for his work on the close-up. He talks about, you know, how the close-up in cinema is truly cinematic. It's he's sort of writing in the period when people are still working really hard to argue why cinema should be regarded as a legitimate art form. And one of the claims he makes about medium specificity is that the close-up in cinema gives us something that none of the other media can give us, and it gives us access to the face, like, which is, you know, theater does that and painting does that, but cinema does it in a different way. It's to, you know, these grandiose proportion, and it's moving, and it's the real face. And Balázs makes these claims that close-ups of the face in cinema give us access to the psychological interiority of the subject. That the actor, to come back to the term acting, that the actor can compose themselves in a particular way for the camera. And yet, because of the cinematic close-up being so large and so intimate, we are allowed to see, we capture moments where involuntary gesture works against voluntary performance. And for Balázs, those moments of involuntary gesture, which he would describe as the kind of microscopic physiognomy of the face, the little twitch that you sort of notice that sort of calls into question the performance, the controlled aspect of the performance. For him, those involuntary gestures were access to the truth of that person. Now, that sounds like a ridiculous claim, But pornography makes a similar claim, that it's the involuntary gesture that gives us access to the truth of the subject. And so the moment of ejaculation in hardcore pornography would be the most famous example of that, that when we see that, we know that the actor is not faking it, that that really happened, and that sort of involuntary gesture is proof that some kind of sexual pleasure is actually taking place, as opposed to all the kind of voluntary contortions and the actor sort of screaming and this mock pleasure that we don't believe. And so for me, there's something about Anne Buchanan's face producing the tears involuntarily when she decides, she makes the voluntary gesture of not moving, and we have the involuntary response of the tears, that makes us feel as if we are seeing right into her. And it's not psychology that's being offered up, but it's physiology, that Warhol's offering us the truth of the body, that if you don't blink for 3 minutes, you're going to cry. And there's something pornographic in that revelation when the body's truth can be made so manifestly visible. And so I would compare the involuntary tears to sort of pornography's ejaculatory moment.
I just want to say that I find that very convincing. I just want to add that I think Henry Geltzoller does the same thing. The film is a very Bela Balogian film.
Yeah.
But this is sort of more to the point where the tears are actually the equivalent of the semen and the
One of the other things, we saw so many screen tests. You guys really, you did well. It was a long program. We saw so many, so I can't say. I know that by the end of the program, we're all sort of just very tired. But often what happens, I screen that one of Anne Buchanan, you know, regularly in my classes and stuff. And I always like to watch the audience. It was actually, you know, a bit too dark, and I was a bit too tired to watch you all. But what I notice is that there's some kind of spectatorial mimicry that happens where we become transfixed with her wide-eyed gaze, and a lot of us also kind of, I don't know if we don't blink for the entire 4 minutes of the projection, but we stare wide-eyed at her staring at the camera wide-eyed, that we have this kind of imitative response. And that is something that is also relevant to pornography, which has been described by film theorists like Linda Williams and Carol Clover as a body genre, that it, in, along with melodrama and horror, that the bodily spectacle on screen kind of compels us to mimic it. So in a horror film, when the heroine screams, we scream. That's when horror works, is when it compels an involuntary mimicry. And I feel like something like that happens in Anne Buchanan also, that we become very aware of the act of watching physiologically.
And that's what I really find interesting, because for me it was not imitation of it, but I did the same thing with the wide eyes, because I just wanted to see whether she really doesn't blink. And when I'm blinking, I can miss it at some point.
So that's again the authenticating, right? Like we're trying to like find proof that the body really does this in front of the camera.
And that's another interesting point, because we saw a lot of screen tests throughout these 10 months, and normally I don't know the people that are sitting there, and I imagine what their story is, who they are, who they could be. And especially at the three women that try not to blink, or the last one, of course, especially does, I forget that. And I only think how biologically that works, as you said it. And that's a real interesting point for me as a person in the audience, that the effect changes completely for me. Yeah.
I mean, that's one of, I mean, I can go on, I promise I won't. But one of the, when I say that Warhol makes an incredible contribution to portraiture, like as a concept, is if you think about the history of portraiture, and I know there are art historians here can do a much better job, that what portraiture traditionally was concerned with was, on the one hand, status, the status of the sitter, and sort of showing off the wealth and the clothes and the jewelry and the opulent setting and the importance of the sitter. But then, you know, moving into the 19th and 20th century, psychology, right? The psychology of the sitter, when we think about, you know, Warhol's, Picasso's portraits of Dora Maar is something, that there are these psychological portraits. And then what Warhol changes, he's interested in status, you know, in celebrity and also in psychology, but he makes physiology or corporeality central in his investigation of portraiture. That what we're seeing here, you know, like a lot of the subjects are quite famous in their own milieus. Some are recognizable, some are not. I forgot who some of them are. So there is that aspect, but we're getting a portrait of this subject as social subject, but also as a body. And I would say that that's a really new, different contribution that Warhol makes, is that interest in portraiture as like portraiture of physicality.
Kalani.
Yeah, I was interested in what you might have to say about randomness in some of these reels. So like in the first one, when the woman is holding up her hair and we're kind of drawn not to what's happening with her face, but the strands that are falling from, mm-hmm. you know, out of her hands mm-hmm. from this mm-hmm. performance. And I was also thinking about, I don't know, maybe this is too much of a conceptual leap, but like, you know, Fluxus instructions where you're given, you know, a set of structures, and within that structure, every time you perform it, something unique happens.
Yeah.
And the couch, I think, is such a nice pairing because yeah. it's also structuring the body.
Yeah.
And like in your talk, you've said so beautifully all the ways in which the body kind of tries to defy that structure.
Yeah.
So what about randomness and like elements of chance?
I mean, that's a beautiful point, and I'm so glad that you're getting the resonance between couch and the screen test, right? Because they're interested in that seriality that so many of the silk screens are interested in also, but chance and change, how those emerge in a pattern of similarity or sameness. So the first screen test is of dancer and performer Beverly Grant and the crazy hair, and she was married to Tony Conrad, and they were both really involved in Fluxus and John Cage's ideas about chance. And so you're absolutely right. And one of the things that's so interesting is that knowing, you know, part of the surround, the social surround of these characters, which Callie Angel provides so well and exhaustively in that catalog of the screen test. You know, it's like knowing who these people are. It's not essential to watching it, but it's interesting. And so it's interesting, I always think, to see how the dancers deal with the screen tests. Because it's like when you think about, you know, the kind of Hollywood screen test, it's to show off your talents. And here Warhol's saying, well, don't move, right? And so what emerges is how you deal, how you introduce movement, or how you introduce personality or charisma or whatever that elusive quality a screen test, you know, a Hollywood screen test might be searching for. And there it's like precisely in the kind of chance cascading of the hair that you're so right to point out, that she's holding the pose and it's when the pose breaks, right? But it's not about, she does break the pose, you know, she moves her arms and stuff, but it's about, there's something very particular when the hair breaks, because that's the part that exceeds her conscious control, right? That introduces a different element of nuance and chance.
It's also how to have presence.
Right.
Like how, and for me, I know Henning has something to say, and for me, like the screen test, I think it was Ed Hood who is on My Hustlers. For me, he has, maybe I just don't like him, but he just has zero presence, and he's trying really hard to be there, to stare down the camera. And so I think that's another like fascinating quality. And I felt, I know one time when I was doing research on the screen test and Callie Angel, in relation to my back on my dissertation research on Hollywood, and Callie Angel suggested I look at the screen tests where Warhol actually worked with people who were Hollywood stars. And because she felt, she couldn't really specify it, but she felt that they had a different presence mm-hmm. from the camera. Like there's screen tests, there are few of them, but Dennis Hopper, his wife Brooke Hayward, who I wondered, I don't know, but I wondered if that yeah. was, does anyone know what Brooke Hayward looks like? I wondered if that was the woman the really strikingly.
That is what she looks like. I think that's her.
I don't know if that's her either. The one really beautiful screen test where she was all the way to the right of the image. And that seemed to me interesting because she wasn't looking at the camera, which seemed to me perhaps, but I don't know. I don't know if that's her. Anyway, and Zachary Scott and Ruth Ford were a few others, but I just wanted to raise that other issue of.
And that screen test is, it's like Bergman-esque.
Yeah.
You know, like, I don't want to theorize the difference between acting and performance, but that one would be a really good place to start. You know, like what constitutes, I mean, I don't know enough about either of them, but that feels so differently, not only because of the angle, but the way she's inhabiting this persona that seems other than the body, you know?
Yeah, Henning Engel.
Before I come to my proper question, who was the second to last screen test of?
With the short hair, that's, I don't know. We're so out of practice.
Yeah.
You remember?
Was that the short hair? Did she have short hair? There was the blonde.
Dark hair.
The long neck and the.
No, not the long neck.
We'll email you.
I thought she looked a little bit like Amy Taubin, but I wasn't sure.
Oh, no, it's not Amy. Yeah, Amy Taubin has, you know, from also the couch reel.
Yeah.
With the three women and then the man. She was like the third woman to our right. And she has, like, you know, always had that kind of bob.
We can find out. We have the list, but we're like, we were forgetting while we were watching.
Yeah.
But what I really wanted to ask is, in your talk, you spoke about this indefinitely prolonged climax that Warhol is interested in.
Yeah.
And I think this might relate to the question about the randomness and the chance and the involuntary gestures. In a sense that this was, of course, this idea of the indefinitely prolonged climax was not only part of, well, was not only seen as a sexual climax, but it was also seen in an aesthetic sense that this would deviate from the long European tradition of not only narration, but of art, of music that would lead to a climax. And John Cage and others started to explore this kind of not really serial and other forms of additive structures. And in this process, they also introduced elements of chance and involuntary things and the audience participated and so on. And I was wondering if you could comment on, this would seem to be a redeeming aspect of the film, but it also somehow mirrors the indefinitely prolonged climaxes of consumer society.
What do you mean it would be a redeeming aspect? I'm not...
For John Cage, it would be... And
you're saying that sort of refusal of the climax is
the
like
refusal of the climax might be there might be some redeeming aspect in this.
Absolutely, and I think that's like central to what I was trying to communicate. It's interesting to think about narrative. I think when I'm thinking about Warhol's sex films, that, you know, I was comparing what Marcuse talks about, the primacy of the genital being equivalent to what I call the tyranny of narrative. And that Warhol is simultaneous. He's trying to resist both at the same time. And the difficulty of making a sex film is like you bring the genitals on screen and they threaten to provoke that kind of narrative and sexual climax that he's trying so hard to resist. That's the difficulty of making actual pornographic films, right, that show genital intercourse. One of the things, like, you know, if you think about Anne Buchanan's screen test, I think it's more explicitly pornographic and more narratively driven than the entire film of Couch, right? Because it's like there's a problem. It's like classical narrative in a way. It's resolved, you know, like it has like the third act and comes down and she actually gives it its maximum visibility, its frontal staging, and she actually gives it to us. And yet in the context of Warhol's other work and the fact that it's tears and you can't, I'm going off on a tangent, but the distinction between like the affect of pain that the tears convey and then the fact that it's just a physiological response, this like brings in some interest. But yes, I agree with you that avoiding narrative climax is not only part of what's happening in so many art movements of the 60s, but central to the project of Couch. And yet giving narrative climax and physiological climax is also, can be totally subversive, as we see in Anne Buchanan, right? It's like redefining what narrative might mean or what sexual climax might constitute.
Maybe it's good to end with sexual climax.
But a very last question. The series ends right now, and it has the title Easier Than Painting. Would you comment on that?
You don't like this title, do you, Urs?
I like it, but I want to hear it.
Okay, sorry.
I'm going to triangulate this conversation. I don't know the backstory, but honestly, everything's easier than painting.
As a painter.
As a painter, I will tell you, every single thing is easier. Everything I do is easier than painting.
And filmmaking, too.
Filmmaking, writing, sex, everything is easier than painting. So that's all I have to say about that.
Thank you very much. Thank you
so much. Thank you, everyone. And also, especially Mark. Thank you for bringing me here.
Thank you, Ara.
Please think of it. The real final is on Thursday next week, not on Sunday. And please come back to the discussion. And der letzte Satz in Deutsch. Es geht auch noch weiter danach mit diesen Lectures. Wir enden damit jetzt nicht, sondern ab Oktober, das kann man, glaube ich, in der kleinen Runde jetzt schon mal ankündigen, geht's weiter mit Pasolini. Und dann machen wir 10 Monate dazu. Kommen Sie gut nach Hause. Bis bald.